This is example of makeup. In the I one of my hobbies in the free time is just to travel around various places like caverns and stuff and just go to the souvenir place and get a piece of something. And one thing I discovered is a lot of those stuff are made outside of the United States, even though they portray native stuff, right? So you have those Native American Indians, but they're not made in America. They're made somewhere else, usually like China or somewhere else. But for the sake of non-discrimination principle, I decided to assign India. Those plastic toys or plastic figurines, they're usually made from pellets like this, which are molded. You have a mold, they're molded under the pressure, and then they're sold. So you have India, United States, and I use an example of German tourist who also has his own shop, right? He came in, he loved it, so he decided to bring him. He placed a purchaser in the United States who used Indian pellets to make this product, and was not sold in the United States but sold in Germany. This is a classic case of manufacturing drawback, where you use stuff from outside to make things inside the United States and then export it out. Whatever duty you paid on plastic pellets is subject to the 99% refund. So substitution is the stuff that I talked about earlier. Key point is in substitution case, 3 years. Remember, we had 5 years, now we have, it goes down to 3 years. So it cannot be year number four. You substitution must take place by year number three. What's the test? The test is of the same kind and quality, which is kind of ambiguous. And because it's ambiguous, usually custom examiners will tell you the merchandise is of same kind of quality. And once you see that, okay, you are probably in a world of question dealing with substitution, whether it's manufacturing or unused merchandise. Here we're still in manufacturing, right? So domestic article. So first, there must have been an import. Second, we must have domestic article, and that domestic article must be of the same kind of quality as that import, right? So you have import, you have domestic. Later on, you're going to switch them up. Of course, domestic does not have to be used. That doesn't apply to imported, right? Imported can be used, but domestic cannot be used. And domestic in the United States. So you can't, I don't know, use like a second-hand figurine. It has to be like brand new, I suppose. That's what I mean by not used. And it must be exported or destroyed. But also notice, the exportation must be within, so while substitution must take place within 3 years, the exportation can take place within 5 years in the case of manufacturing. So here is the example, right? And just to make it simple, right, I break it down into year one, year two. So year one, you have this gift shop in Montana doing this, right? In year two, you have this gift shop, right? The supplier who made it for the gift shop in Montana, he imported from India, right? But that supplier decided to not supplier, but the manufacturer. When he had a purchaser from Munich, he sourced the pellets from that were made in the United States. Right? So what he's done is he kind of substituted one for another when he claimed drawback. So he was not entitled to claim manufacturing drawback here. Why? Because it was used in the United States, right? In a gift shop in Montana. Everyone knows that Montana is part of the United States. What happened in 1993? Remember the Fremont compound? Montana said, oh, we're independent. FBI went in and I think they put everyone in jail. So Montana is still part of the union. Wow. Hi-fi, I think they heard my Montana comment. Year two, Munich, Germany. Not United States, never was. No, it was protectorate. I think it was within the US protectorate right after World War II for the short period of time. Remember, there were three zones, one to the Soviet Union, one to the United States, one to Great Britain, allies. I think they were controlling that, but besides that short period, right, it was still, it's still like independent, not United States, right? So now I'm thinking about it, I need to change this to some other country, which was never part of the United States. But I didn't, that thought only came to me right now as I spoke. So, without further brain pollution, you can do the substitution here, and you, in year two, you can claim the duty, 99% duty for this, simply by fact of you exporting this. So you say, yes, I took this from the United States, but I would like to substitute, pretend like this was like a substitution, not pretend, it was substitution, right? And then use this. So I would like to use this for this. The key point is that all those places took place in the United States. Yeah? Yeah? Anyone doesn't like this idea? Thinks it's confusing, tricky, mischievous?
Should that mean that, you know, you import all this material in the first place from India?
Yeah, outside, India, China, wherever, outside the United States. This cannot be United States.
So
but this can be United States.
But the second year you did not import any?
No.
Oh, okay.
All the local stuff.
Okay.
That's the key. Otherwise, let's say this was India. You would have no substitution, but you have direct here. But here, it was used in the United States, so you cannot claim the duty here for this one. But, so if this was India here, you would be entitled to this transaction, but not to this transaction, because this was consumed in Montana. It was used in Montana. Yeah? Make sense? Okay, moving on. So, unused. So we're here now. We already touched upon in the shoe example of stuff being used versus unused. Also, you have elements. Also, 99% refund. Because we're in non-NAFTA territory. If it was NAFTA, 100%. So, just like with manufacturing, there must be an import. Just like with manufacturing, it cannot be used. Just like with manufacturing, you have to export it or destroy it. But unlike with manufacturing, the exportation or destruction must take place before the close of the three-year cycle, of the three-year period, beginning of the date of importation. So you have January 2013, date of importation. If you wait until January 2nd, 2016, 3 years, no. January 1st, last day, 2016. 3 years, that's the idea. 5 years with the direct, with the manufacturing, 3 years. So 3 years in manufacturing for substitution to take place, right? But not for exportation destruction. 5 years for exportation destruction. Aha. So, 3 years for substitution. So, here, oops, I beg your pardon. Okay, so let's nail this point home, because I think I saw some question marks on your forehead. How far can we extend this? So the substitution must take place within 3 years. So this made on year one. This substitution takes place on year three. But exportation has to take place on year five. That means he can sit on his butt for two more years before exporting it to Munich. Make sense? If it was unused merchandise, if this guy was not manufacturing, making the toys, his time just shrunk by 2 years. So now you have 3 years. And this is what this timeline is about. 3 years. And of course, just like with everything, we need to pay important attention to the verbiage, because in the case of manufacturing, pretty much we know manufacturing means making new article of commerce, right? From pellets we make toy figurines. But because some operations can take a high degree of complexity, we actually need to draw a line somewhere. What does it mean to manufacture, and what does it mean not to manufacture? And customs, by regulation, came out with a definition. They define manufacturer production as stuff like assembly. You rivet the screws together. And assembly transforms the article into new different article of commerce. It has distinctive name, character, and use. It's no longer a pellet, it's a toy figurine. Or it can be fit for particular use. So I make a new tool. So I take the plastic pellet and I make a trigger for the pistol. Yeah? By itself it's just a part, but it's fit only for the pistol. Why did I say that? Because as I was driving one day, I think last week, I was listening to NPR, and you heard about those 3D printers, right? 3D printer is a printer which uses the process of plastic extrusion, they melt the plastic, and then they spray it on and make this new article, just like you put it into the program. So if I want to make a replica, a plastic replica of my face, they scan my face in, and they make, they can cut out, and they can extrude and make this new article, right, from plastic, which looks like my face. This is like 3D printer. And as I was listening to that, I saw a lot of, so there were some people who bought those printers, and they were making gun parts at home. Because after this shooting in Newtown, this was a life issue, and the question was whether they required to be registered with the ATF and things like that. So they were producing this at home, gun parts at home. Was it subject to the regulation? Probably yes. So they were required to be registered, but they were manufacturing a new article from the blank, in other words. So, but another question came up is that a client called me just 2 weeks before, and there is a local factory here in Brooklyn that makes 3D printers. So they were planning to streamline the export to Europe. So what's the classification of the 3D printer came to mind? And this was a good exercise. I'm still talking with the parties, but basically, off the top of your head, what do you think the 3D printer would be classified? Would it be classified as a printer? You know, like a jet laser printer or not? This is a way that we're taking a break from drawback excitement. Would you think of 3D printer as a printer? Because there is printing provision for the HTSUF. No, my argument is no, because it's two-dimensional. my argument is the 3D printer is a machinery for working plastics. And whether it is used by cutting from the block or by extruding and molding the plastic and kind of spraying it on, because there is different technology, it can be classified as extruder or other machinery for working plastics. Since it's a new technology, I don't think there is rulings out there. I haven't found any. So this is in the works, but kind of relevant here to manufacturing, production, all that stuff. Think about ordering plastic pellets from China and making a 3D printer parts and exporting it. Most of, as we, as our nation switches to this high-tech stuff, right? If we switch from manufacturing nation, mostly manufacturing nation, to the service nation, but now there is a trend to those manufacturing that took that state, they're mostly in high-tech world, right? So this is one of the trends that if you stay in the industry long enough, you will see come across your table. So this is has real implications, which will affect your work, in my opinion. But let's go back to our discussion of drawback. So now we are unused merchandise drawback, the substitution level. So that's and while I mention this again, I mention this again and again, you must have two types of merchandise. You must have an import and you must have a substitution. Substituted merchandise is usually domestic merchandise, which you substitute for the import. And the elements are as follows. You have an import, you have imported pellets, or you have imported yarn, whatever. And you have substituted merchandise. And that merchandise is commercially interchangeable with imported. So this is the second element. The third element is that substituted merchandise is exported or destroyed. So those figurines that were made from substituted or those shoes, remember the different lot that in my hypothetical with Australia, right? They were substituted and exported. So the fourth element, or destroyed, the fourth element is that exportation and destruction of substituted merchandise is done within 3 years. There is a 3-year rule which stays with us, right? Fifth element is substituted merchandise is not used in the United States. So that means imported merchandise can be used, but substituted merchandise cannot be used. And sixth, substituted merchandise was in possession. Remember that possession requirement in the table on the page 203 that I talked about, the possession one? There is that possession requirement. What's the possession? There is a definition. They actually went and defined what the possession is. It's physical or operational control. So whenever you think of possession, think about your keys to your car. Not the title, which is the bank, but keys to the car, which you can come in, drive, and go to do your business. Now, let me see. 191.31. So, remember the point for outlines? I said it's just to break down things more simply. Just to tell you how that outline that I just went over, how it is stated in the regulation, so you can appreciate the difference. Let's read this substitution drawback, right? The one I just mentioned, there's five elements. They're stated in this little paragraph. Right? Drawback on merchandise, which is commercially interchangeable with imported merchandise, if commercially interchangeable merchandise is exported or destroyed under customs supervision before the close of the three-year period beginning the date of importation of the imported merchandise, and before such exportation of destruction, the commercially interchangeable merchandise is not used in the United States, see paragraph E, and is in the possession of a party claiming drawback. This is that five-step paragraph that I talked about. You like it? This is the same thing of what I just broke down. It's right here. How you know that? Well, because, as I said, I don't make stuff up. When I say something, I make a reference to, right? So everyone sees the reason for those outlines that they come out. It's how good our discussion could have been if we were just talking about CFR. So, it's just another point of saying that this is not just to make things easier, and it's a restatement, but the language itself can be sometimes archaic, awkward, and sometimes ambiguous and confusing. So deconstruction is the key here. So now we get to the third variation, rejected. And here is the situations for rejected. It must be defective, right? So you don't like it. It doesn't work. You get the shipment of the phones don't work. Shipped without consent. Of course I need, right? Course I need is the person who receives it, right? I did not authorize these clowns. I authorized Barbie dolls. Don't send me these clowns. I want Barbies. No, they ship clowns. No consent, rejected. Fails to conform to sample specifications. So usually before you make a purchase order for whatever merchandise, you get a sample. So whenever I make a plush toy, let's say a teddy bear, with a smiling teddy bear, right? I give them a sample, I ask them, produce a sample of the teddy bear that you can do. They send me the sample with a smiling teddy bear. I said, very well. I like that teddy bear, it smiles. So send me, make me 1,000 of those smiley bears. They send me, they make me 1,000 teddy bears, but guess what, they are not smiling. They're angry teddy bears. No, kids will be scared. Doesn't conform to the sample, I have the sample, rejected. And why you need that? Because when you claim this type of merchandise, you will need to make a proof. And the best proof is the sample on hand and the actual product received, in addition to the other requirements of paperwork. So, and the three-year provision. So we have a five-year, three-year for export. No, don't confuse that three-year with a three-year record retention, right? So you file it within 3 years, you receive your money, let's say within 3 years, 3 months. On top of that, add 3 years to retain the documents, right? How is that different from others? Because it's 3 years, not 5 years. The stuff that you normally would retain for your entry documents, general rule. Any questions on this? So we just went over the principles. There is more. There is more, but those are the basics. I think this is good enough to get a good idea, and would suffice, at least in the retrospect of the last customs broker exam, this knowledge which we discussed would suffice for you to answer most questions. Yeah. Which one, the manufacturing substitution or... For unused merchandise.
So manufacturer substitution is still 5 years?
No. Well, hold on a sec, let me see. So manufacturing drawback substitution 3 years.
So manufacturing direct is 5 years.
Yes.
Substitution 3 years.
So the year one, you bring this yarn in. The year one, you make your apparel. You can put it in a warehouse for 5 years, and on year five, export it. You're still entitled to claim your drawback. Substitution, you may bring your yarn from China on year one, right? You make your apparel. You sell it year one. If you, after year three, make something from domestic merchandise and export it, and you're outside of the 3 year window, then you cannot claim. You must done something from the domestic merchandise within the 3 years. Yeah? So this is the difference.